Atherosclerosis is one of the most common killers and causes of suffering around the world, and particularly in our society. Atherosclerosis is the most common cause of heart attack and also a major cause of stroke. Atherosclerosis is the buildup of fatty material in the blood vessels of the body, and particularly the arteries, which are the vessels that carry the oxygenated blood to the various parts of the body. Atherosclerosis can actually cause blockages of these arteries that ultimately can lead to heart attack, stroke, or other problems. Now, how do these blockages occur? Well, fatty material and cholesterol and other things build up in the arteries to cause slow narrowing, and then these arteries can either slowly narrow off or actually rupture, a bit like a pimple bursts when we're adolescents. And if that pimple bursts, there's a sudden blood clot and the artery blocks almost instantly, causing a heart attack or stroke or other problems. So atherosclerosis is quite a complex disease, and I like to think of the cause of this disease in two parts. The first is genetics, and the second part is environmental or acquired exposures. So first, in terms of genetics, there are thousands of genes that all contribute to the causality of atherosclerosis. And we are starting to understand more and more about these genes. And in most people with atherosclerosis, it appears that these hundreds or thousands of genes each give a minor contribution to the likelihood of acquiring the disease. In terms of the other or environmental factors, these are things like diabetes, high blood pressure, smoking, lack of exercise, high salt diet, and so on. And all of these factors combined are what go on to cause atherosclerosis. The symptoms of atherosclerosis can be quite different and varied from different people. It can change from sudden death for someone who has a heart attack and dies suddenly, to more slow and progressive symptoms like pain in the legs when we're walking if there's atherosclerosis causing blockages of the arteries to the leg. Other features can include angina, which is a recurrent heart pain we get when we're exercising. Or people can actually go on to have kidney problems and go on to dialysis. And so kidney failure is yet another one of the features of atherosclerosis. And indeed, different ethnicities and races tend to have different proportions of the features of atherosclerosis. For example, African American and Indigenous Australian people tend to suffer from peripheral vascular disease or pain in the legs when they're walking and kidney problems, whereas Caucasians tend to suffer more from heart attacks and strokes. So is atherosclerosis different in men and women? Yes, it is. In men, it tends to occur about a decade earlier, and it tends to also occur in association with specific risk factors such as smoking, diabetes, and being overweight. In women, atherosclerosis tends to come on about a decade later, but is also associated with specific risk factors such as high blood pressure and age. The manifestations of atherosclerosis can also be a little bit different from men and women. Men tend to suffer from heart attacks. Women also do, however, the chest pain and the features of the heart attack can be quite different from men and women. The best way to actually diagnose atherosclerosis is before we've had any events, before we've had a heart attack or a stroke, obviously. So atherosclerosis can be fairly reliably predicted by different risk scores, but by calculating risk based on things like diabetes, age, smoking status, cholesterol levels, and so on, we can fairly reliably predict who's got the most severe forms of atherosclerosis and what their likelihood of having a heart attack, stroke, or death over the next 10-year period is. There's other ways to diagnose atherosclerosis that also include imaging studies such as CT angiography or invasive catheter-based angiography such as a coronary angiogram. So atherosclerosis is actually a fairly treatable disease, and we actually now have very effective medications that can reduce cholesterol to reduce the amount of atherosclerosis. So the medications we're all familiar with are these statin drugs, such as atorvastatin, simvastatin, rosuvastatin. And there are even newer, more powerful medications called PCSK9 inhibitors that have just come on the market. And these medications can powerfully reduce cholesterol and also reduce the extent of blockages. We can't fully undo the blockages or fully stop atherosclerosis, but we can, by medication, reduce the amount of blockage. It's also important to say that we can open blocked arteries by procedures, such as coronary artery bypass graft surgery, which actually bypasses a blockage, or stenting, which can actually open a blocked artery once it's actually become occluded. both globally and at the Victor Chang Cardiac Research Institute, there are intense efforts that are underway to better understand atherosclerosis and to develop more focused target treatments.